Yes, sir.
A very warm welcome to all of you. We welcome you all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We are extremely happy that all of us could join from all over the world in a form like this, in this online mode. So we'll have a formal welcome later by Krupa. Right now, I'll request Brother Jayashil, who is our CNMO staff worker, to pray and open the do the opening prayer and start the program. Over to Jayashil.
Shall we pray? Our most gracious, loving Heavenly Father, what a great joy, Lord, this evening to come together, worship you, thank you, to remember, Lord, your servant, Dr. T.N. Starrett, and Lord, Sister Eloise, and their love and sacrifice and life this evening. We praise you, Lord, for each one of us who are gathered on this Zoom platform. And Lord, we want to thank you for this privilege of coming together and learning together the life and the ministry, what they have done, Lord, in India, especially with UVSI. Thank you, Lord, for raising them as first staff of UVSI, and their love in UVSI, Lord, even gifting the high field, and also, Lord, being a great challenge, and also model lifestyle family, which nurtured, built many individuals in this place. We want to thank you. We commit this entire program into your hands, Lord. We pray for Dr. Joseph Janana as he anchors the entire program. We remember all the resource servants, Lord, who are sharing about the life and ministry of Dr. Starrett and family. We also thank you, Lord, for all the participants. May we encouraged and edified and, Lord, equipped and also, Lord, impacted through this time. We thank you. We give you all glory, committing all of us into your hands. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Amen.
So right now we'll have a welcome and introduction, formal introduction by Krupa Christy, who is our one of the board members, student board members. Yeah, over to Christy, Krupa Christy, please. She will also be introducing the resource persons.
Just, I'm afraid, I think Krupa is missing. That's not
true. Actually, she had some issues, technical issues. She just pinged that to me.
Yeah. So, Brother Frankie, would you like to do the introduction and also the PPT, the resource persons can be introduced?
Charles.
Yeah. Is she joining, Krupa? Or maybe I'll just go ahead. Yeah. So thank you, Brother Joseph John. So Dear all, welcome to this wonderful evening where we will be hearing about Dr. T.N. Sterrett. And we have several resource persons who have put in a lot of thoughts to this program. And they are the people who have been close to Dr. Sterrett in some way or the other. And we have with us this this evening, we have Dr. Joseph John, who we have just heard. He'll be he's actually anchoring the program. And we also have with us Dr. A. Arjunan. So he's our dear brother who many of you may know. He is the author of the book that has the biography of Dr. T.N. Sterrett, Tale of a Legend. So we have with us Dr. A. Arjunan. We also have Professor Tally Allinger, and then Auntie Shirley Christopher. We'll hear more about them a little later. And then we also have the granddaughter of T.N. Sterrett, Jennifer, who is joining us from the United States. And we have with us also Reverend Arthur Hope and Uncle Cyril Kunder. So they will be the panel who will be actually introducing us and giving us insight into this great man of God. So over to you, Dr. Joseph John.
Yeah, so right now we'll have by the a recorded song by the CMTC students, Jesus Commanded Us Something to Do. This was a song which was composed and written by Dr. Sterrett while he was with UASI. And this song has been and always been a blessing, and it was written in a context where he felt that there is a need to love one another. So over to the media team to play this recorded song by the CMT students who are right now in high grade. Composed and written by Dr. Sterrett while he was in UASI. And this song has composed by the We are sorry about media problem. So let me continue. I think Krupa has joined. Krupa, would you like to please give a formal welcome and also introduction, please? Or
hello, good evening. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, Krupa, you're audible.
Actually, I was trying to unmute, but my mic was disabled by the host. Yeah. Hello?
Yes, Krupa. So I'll do one.
Okay. So good evening, everyone. Praise the Lord. I'm Krupa Christie from Gujarat, and currently I represent myself as NSC chairperson of UESI. And I would like to welcome you all on this wonderful evening. And it is such a delight to have you all here. And I want to appreciate all of you that you have joined in such a big number, and you have chosen to be with us in this hour. And each one of us present over here has been a part of UESI family in one and the other way, right? So as you all know, today we have met to recall one of our great person and our first staff worker of UESI. And I would like to take pleasure to welcome you all. You know, when we look back to our pioneering ministry, we can see that time flies so fast and everything gets shaped in a better way by God's provision. But various persons' involvement and their efforts have laid this, but the foundation, the person who laid the foundation has been worth remembering. So right now, we give a heartfelt welcome to each and everyone present over here. And I would like to take this opportunity to also welcome our resource persons that we have with us this evening. So we have their beautiful pictures with us. And I would like to request to share the screen. We give a heartfelt welcome to each and everyone present over here. And I would like to take this opportunity to also welcome our resource persons that we have with us this evening. So we have their beautiful pictures with us. And I would like to request to share the screen. Yes, hello. We give a heartfelt welcome to each and everyone present over here. And I would like to take this opportunity to also welcome our resource persons that we have with us this evening. So we have their beautiful pictures with us. And I would like to request to share the screen.
Krupa, the screen is shared. Maybe you have a bandwidth problem.
We give a heartfelt welcome to each and everyone present over here. And I would like to take this opportunity to also welcome our resource persons that we have with us this evening. So we have their beautiful pictures with us. And I would like to request to share the screen.
The screen is already shared.
Have a bandwidth problem.
We give a heartfelt welcome to each and everyone present over here. And I would like to take this opportunity to also welcome our resource persons that we have with us this evening. So we have their beautiful pictures with us. And I would like to request to share the screen.
The screen is already shared.
Have a bandwidth problem.
We give a heartfelt welcome to each and everyone present over here. And I would like to take this opportunity to also welcome our resource persons that we have with us this evening. So we have their beautiful pictures with us. and I would like to request to share the screen.
The screen is already shared.
We give a heartfelt welcome to each and everyone present over here. And I would like to take this opportunity to also welcome our resource persons that we have with us this evening. So we have their beautiful pictures with us. And I would like to request to share the screen.
Shekhar, why don't we skip this program, move on to the
next. Screen is already shared. And
have a bandwidth problem.
We give a heartfelt welcome to each and everyone present over here. And I would like to take this opportunity to also welcome our resource persons that we have with us this evening. So we have their beautiful pictures with us. And I would like to request to share the screen.
Shekhar, why don't we skip this program, move on to the
next. The screen is already shared. And
have a bandwidth problem.
We give a heartfelt welcome to each and everyone present over here. And I would like to take this opportunity to also welcome our resource persons that we have with us this evening. So we have their beautiful pictures with us. And I would like to request to share the screen.
Shekhar, why don't we skip this program, move on to the
next. The screen is already shared. And
have a bandwidth problem.
We give a heartfelt welcome to each and everyone present over here. And I would like to take this opportunity to welcome our resource persons that we have with us.
Stop the program and start again.
We have their beautiful pictures with us. And I would like to request to share the screen.
Shekhar.
Yeah. Thank you. I think just we can carry on.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Once again, sorry for the, I think, serious problem. Let me go ahead with the next one. What I'll be doing is, I'll be giving a very brief introduction about the steroids, and the resource people would be giving more detailed introduction rather through the interview. So let me just share the screen. So the today's the purpose of this is the first of the lecture on Dr. T.N. Steret. Now, one of the main reason why we have such a lecture is that Hebrews 13:7 it says, "Remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith." Now, when we read this verse very clearly talks about three things. First, to remember our leaders. So today, we remember the Sterets and the way they ministered with UASI in the initial days, and we remember them. And also, we recollect or we consider the various aspects of their sacrificial life, the way they ministered to many students and staff workers and graduates throughout the country. And finally, the purpose is not just to remember and recollect, but finally to replicate or imitate their faith. So the purpose of today's talk, the lecture, is that we will be challenged and inspired. We would look to the Lord so that we could imitate their example in our lives as we minister to the Lord in different parts of the country. I would be giving a very brief timeline of the Sterets, and the other details other resource persons will give. Dr. Steret was born in 1912 in Persia, in Urmia, Persia, which is the modern Iran. And he was born to missionary parents. So he was born as he was brought up as a missionary kid. In 1938, he was married to Alois. And the very next year, they came to India, 1939. Dr. Sterrett and his wife, Alois, they served as the InterVarsity Christian Fellowship staff with IFES. And they also served as part-time faculty of the Bible School at Jhansi in India, many, many years. Now, it was Brother Bhakt Singh who got introduced to Dr. Sterrett, and he made it a point to introduce Dr. Sterrett to Professor Enoch. Professor Enoch, in turn, invited Dr. Sterrett to speak in the EU meetings organized by Madras EU. And in those days, in the early 50s, Dr. Sterrett used the Moody science film, The God of Creation. Now, I saw this this Moody science film, The God of Creation, is still available on, you can see this on YouTube, and it's wonderful. And even today, it's a wonderful film to see the God of Creation, the God whom we worship. They became the first staff workers of USI. And 1954, Dr. Sterrett was one among the founding members of USI. And in 1959, they bought the Highfield property. And in 1966, they gifted the Highfield property to USI. In 1971, they authored the book, How to Understand Your Bible. And this was done during their time with USI, and they were particular that this should be published in India for use in India. And later, this book now is published all over the world in many languages. In 1972, Dr. Sterrett started the Asian Bible Studies Center in Highfield, Kotagiri, and the Sterretts served USI till 1975. So they worked with Indian students and graduates and staff. So we praise God for their lives. So right now what we'll have is we'll have an interview with Dr. Arjunan. Now Dr. Arjunan is the one who wrote the biography of Dr. Sterrett, and yeah, I request the media team to spotlight Dr. Arjunan. Yeah, Dr. Arjunan, thank you for joining us. And you wrote the biography of Dr. Ian Sterrett, Tale of a Legend. Please tell us what motivated you to write this biography.
Thank you, Anand, for your warm words. Even now, whenever I hold a copy of The Tale of a Legend by the biography of Dr. Norton Sterrett, I'm really honored. I've been chosen as the worthy vessel to write the biography. So it's my privilege to say a few words what motivated me to write this biography. In fact, I have seen Mrs. Eloise Sterrett in a Silver Jubilee conference in 1979 in Secunderabad, but I never seen Dr. Sterrett. I don't remember what exactly she spoke in the conference, except a few words like EU, EGF, or just links in a chain called UESI. Probably she was emphasizing the unity in the movement called UESI. I went through the book, The Tale of a Legend, and I could see the profound impact Dr. Sterrett and Mrs. Sterrett have made on generations of students, graduates, and staff workers. And I had a longing. I wish I were born a little earlier and had a chance to attend the study program in Highfield. This is only my longing. To coming to the question, what motivated me, in the late 80s, we used to conduct leadership training camps and discipleship camps in Madurai. And Silkundar Annan, who was working with Ambassador for Christ at the time, would be invited as a frequent speaker in Madurai in inner and around Tamil Nadu. So during the time, I used to meet him and discuss on the topics and issues closer to our heart. But I could notice during our conversation, informal conversation, he was referring to one name, Dr. Sterrett, very often, and Eloise Sterrett very often. And sometime he would become emotional and told me, look here, brother, it's all because of Sterretts. What I'm today, it's all because of Sterretts. So that instilled a desire in me to know more about him. In the early 90s, I had a chance to listen to the sermons of Brother Satkirti Rao. And the graduates of my generation, my elders, and my immediate younger generation would testify, Satya, no sermon was complete without reference to Dr. Sterrett. And as you know, Satkirti Rao, P.C. Varghese, Arthur Annan, Shali Christopher Akka, Prema Fanaka were all mentored by Sterretts, Eloise Sterrett and Dr. Sterrett. So he was often referring to many incidents. The incident, the familiar incident is washing, the cleaning the dry latrines in Highfield Center, Kottakery. I was just wondering after listening to the anecdote, a brilliant theologian with a doctoral degree in theology from Dallas University, one of the prestigious seminaries in the world, he could stoop down to this level of cleaning the toilet as a preparation for the next day camp. So I became more inquisitive to know about the man, and I wanted to pass on the generation, the ministry, and the servant leadership of Dr. Sterrett and Mrs. Eloise Sterrett to my generation of graduates and students and the next generation of students as well. This only motivated me, Anand, to write this book, A Tale of a Legend.
Thank you, brother. Please elaborate a few events in the lives of these Sterretts before they come into India.
I want to highlight a few incidents in the lives of Sterrett and Miss Eloise before they moved to India. They were students of Bible College, Columbia Bible College. And then this incident I want to highlight. Sterrett's parents were missionary parents. They were working as missionaries in Iran. And then when they moved to America for health reasons, they were moving their residence to so many places. I read in a reminiscence sent to me that they were moving from Connecticut to California. I checked with the Google map. It's about a range of 3,000 miles. So what I want to say, even as a little boy, a young man, both Sterrett and his sister Emily, who went as a missionary to Africa later, they had the exposure of seeing different kind of people and being in different places. And this, the Sovereign Lord helped them to adapt to many places when they came to India in 1939. And I read somewhere that from 1939 to 1952, they have shifted their residence 40 times. And Jerry, their son, would ask, Mommy, we have been doing this packing, unpacking business. When are we going to end this ordeal, the tedious affair of packing and unpacking? And Mrs. Eloise Sterrett would smile, look up, look above, and told your son only in heaven. So the Lord was preparing the little boy Sterrett for a higher ministry in India. Another incident I want to say that it's about their marriage proposal. And that both of them were in the same class in Columbia Bible College. And Sterrett's father was a Greek teacher. So Sterrett and Eliza were the students of their father. And Sterrett sensed that God was leading him to propose to Eliza's sister, Eliza at the time. So one day he met and proposed to her. But Eliza had two conditions for her life partner. Number one, he must be older than her. Number two, he must be taller than she was. But Sterrett miserably failed in the two areas. He was short in stature, and he was younger to Eliza Sterrett by 2 years. And Eliza did not jump to grab this opportunity and rush to the church for the solemnization of the marriage. She prayed about it for 6 months, sensed God leading and direction. Only after a prayer of 6 months, she said yes to the proposal. So this is how. And another thing I wanted to quote is here. After the marriage, they wanted to go to South America as missionaries. And as we read in the book of Acts, the Spirit of God prevented them and laid a desire and burden to go to India. I was just reflecting on this. Another Spirit of God prevented them. We would have lost Sterrett's. They would not be Highfield, and their influence could not be seen among the students, graduates, and the staff of UESI.
Thank you, brother. Please tell us, how was Dr. Sterrett introduced to UESI? You could, please tell us in a few words.
I think it was in 1948. Dr. Sterrett was the director of Urbana Conference, the IFES conference. He was given the assignment of directing the conference. From India, Brother Buck Singh went there. So they had a meeting, and Dr. Sterrett was sharing his burden to start ministry among the students in India. And this, he had it in mind, Brother Buck Singh. When he came to Madras, he shared this piece of information with Professor Enoch, who was already conducting meeting for students in his house in Poonamalli Road, 190 Poonamalli Road, Madras, I believe. He was already conducting meeting. And Professor Enoch, as we all know, he was a little apprehensive about having a tie-up with a foreign missionaries. So he was reluctant. And Buck Singh persuaded him. In fact, Dr. Sterrett and his wife came here only for this purpose. And they are disguised as Bible teachers in Jhansi. So I can remove all your misgivings, all your doubts and anxieties about him. He is a worthy man. You can consider, you can work with him. And Professor Enoch wrote a letter to him. And Dr. Sterrett rushed to Madras in 1950 with Moody, Science of Film, God and Creation. And the film was making inroads into many colleges in Madras. I think there was a tremendous breakthrough in Stanley Medical College, where many students responded, and the prayer cell was also increasing phenomenally in Professor Enoch's house. And that is how UESI was born. Anand.
Thank you, brother. Please tell us what were the involvements of Dr. Sterrett with other missionary organizations.
Yeah, I was really appreciative of his what I would call genial spirit and generosity in working with other missionary organization where there was no doctrinal deviation. He had one condition. He could collaborate with any organization or a church or denomination or a missionary movement as long as their doctrinal stand would agree with him. And I was taking interview to many people. He has helped a lot for Youth for Christ when Mr. Victor Monogren was in charge of the ministry. He helped him, counseled him. And it is also mentioned in the book, when Youth for Christ was conducting a massive rally with Cyril Thompson as a speaker, many youths and students turned up, and Dr. Sterrett volunteered to be a counselor. There was one particular student, he was struggling with a lot of questions in the conference, the Youth for Christ rally, and Dr. Sterrett sat with him, answered his questions, and this young boy went to a theological college, came back to Madras, and became a pastor in Emmanuel Methodist Church. And then he was also instrumental in the founding of Union Biblical, one of the instruments, not the main instrument, but one of the instruments in the founding of Union Biblical Seminary in 1968, Yothmal. And Dr. Sterrett was the treasurer in Kotagiri Medical Fellowship. And then in 1965, EFI, in the EFI conference, Dr. Theodore Williams proposed the idea of launching a movement called IEM. It was Sterrett who encouraged him and stood with him in founding the organization called IEM. So he had a very good rapport, very good collaboration with many organizations. So his talents, his wise counseling, his devotion and commitment were not completely restricted to USA alone.
Thank you so much, brother. Yeah, thank you so much for giving very detailed and very accurate information about Dr. Sterrett. Thank you so much. Yeah.
Oh, thank you, Anna. It's my pleasure.
So now we'll have a short interview with Mrs. Jennifer Sterrett Ball. Very good morning to you. Even though in India it's a good evening, it's a good morning to you. We are so privileged to have you with us. But as you heard, Dr. Sterrett and Mrs. Sterrett have been such a blessing to UESI, especially in the initial days. And God used them in a very mighty way. And many things, there are so many things for all of us to learn from their lives and to imitate. So we are very privileged to have you with us in this online mode. Please share with us a few things about your grandfather, you know, which we could, whatever you would like to share, please share. And we would like to hear from you. And we challenged and we want to thank God for their lives. Thank you.
Please. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for inviting me. I actually am a little bit embarrassed because I think that I'm learning from listening to you all. I've learned a lot about my grandparents just listening to you and listening to the things that you know about him. I was my grandparents were in India until I was 6 years old, and then my grandpa, Dr. Sterrett, died when I was 9 years old. So I only had a few years to know him. And so I'm always really blessed and encouraged to hear how God used his life, and I'm always learning more. So I feel like I don't probably have too many things to say that you all don't already know, but I am very grateful that you invited me to be here and to be part of this. So I'll just say a few things that I prepared from the things that I remember. And I also want to say that in 2019, I visited Highfield for the very first time. And that was a wonderful thing for me. I had heard stories, and it was so nice to be able to see, to actually see the place and see where my grandparents had lived. But the most striking thing for me, the thing that I have mentioned to other people, is just to see how the Lord has grown that work, and how the very small seeds that my grandparents planted there when they were there have just grown into a wonderful flourishing ministry that has branches, to use this Bible's analogy of the kingdom of God, like a tree. The branches of UESI now spread throughout India. And it's just a wonderful thing to see that God has been so faithful, and that that work has continued and is so strong and in what it does. So I am the granddaughter of Dr. Sterrett. My father was Jerry Sterrett, the son of Dr. Sterrett and Eloise. He came to the United States for college, and that's where he met my mother, also at Columbia Bible College, same place where his parents met. And most of his life, he worked in, he did a variety of things, but he worked in housing construction, and then later he had a social work ministry in Philadelphia. He died in 2018 of prostate cancer. So we have been 4 years without him. When I think about my grandparents' lives, I think it's really a story about the love of Jesus. When my grandparents were in their early 20s, living in the United States having other plans, not plans to go to India, but to go elsewhere, Jesus unmistakably led them to India by the Holy Spirit, as we already heard. In 1939, going to India from the United States meant leaving behind your family and friends and culture. There was no texting or emailing home. And they actually traveled on a steamship. It was very expensive and quite a long journey. So that meant that they really did not come home to the States very often at all during their 36 years. I think that they would have said, as the Apostle Paul said in 2 Corinthians 5:14, that the love of Christ controls us, because we have concluded this, that one has died for all, therefore all have died. And he died for all, that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. My grandparents had encountered the love of Jesus, and as a result, they were no longer living for themselves, but for him. And that meant going where he sent them. They trusted him, although they could not have known all that God and his love would do and had planned for them in India. My grandparents loved India. I was 6 years old when they returned to live in the United States. And I remember my grandmother would show me her saris and her and artwork and textiles and many things that she had brought from India that decorated her apartment where they lived when they first returned home. And she also loved to just tell me many stories, but mostly she and my grandfather just loved to talk about the people, the friends that they had left behind in India. It was a little bit odd for me to hear them talk so familiarly about people that I had never met, but that was what they loved most. They loved most the people with whom they had worked in India in their many years. So really, when they returned to the United States, instead of coming to their family, they really had left their true family behind. Jesus joined their hearts to the hearts of their brothers and sisters in India. So in some way, I'm related to you all, because through them and through the work of Jesus, we're all one family. And that's just a wonderful thing to think about. I've heard much about my grandfather's teaching of the Bible and how important it was to him to teach the Bible, and that students would be able to understand the scriptures and study them for their own, and that that was how they would know and love Jesus. And I remember to my grandmother how much she loved teaching the Bible. She told me much about the many opportunities she had to teach. It was just a great joy to her. And so she would recount that to me many times. And even after they came back from India, they continued to teach the Bible, and they lived at a InterVarsity Retreat Center in New York, and they continued to teach the Bible there. And so that was another thing, that when I was at Highfield was such a wonderful thing to see, is that I could see that that same love for the scriptures and for Bible teaching continues. I was looking at the schedule of the many Bible institutes and Bible training opportunities that are still at the core of UESI's ministry, and that is just a wonderful thing. I've also heard a lot about my grandfather's love for music, And it was really great to hear the song that he wrote, which actually I didn't know about. So I think now Rajesh had told me about that song when I was at Highfield, but I had forgotten about that. My Aunt Anne, last time she visited me before her death, she told me about how her dad would have her play the piano at student meetings. So there could be singing. I've also heard and read about him playing the trumpet early in the morning at student retreats to wake students up for personal prayer and Bible study. And I've often thought how wonderful it would be to hear that. But then I've also thought that honestly, if I were had been a student at Highfield, I might have been a little annoyed to be wakened so early in the morning. But my this love of music, my father also inherited, Jerry, and my mother too was a musician. So my siblings and I grew up with music lessons and lots of music in the house, and my father often leading singing and playing the piano. And you should know that many of Dr. Starrett's great-grandchildren, my children and my siblings' children, are musicians. Quite a few of them have pursued music in their lives. So I just see how Jesus gifted my grandparents in so many ways, with the love of teaching and love of music, and that in through that they shared their gifts with us. And so even now, many years later, on both sides of the ocean, we and you all are joined together as one family, and we are benefiting from these gifts that God gave to Dr. Starrett and his and my grandmother, Eloise. I will finish up by telling you a little bit about our family now. So Eloise and Dr. Starrett had two children, my father, Jerry, and his sister, Anne. Anne lived in Philadelphia most of her life. She never married. She worked at various jobs, including as a nutritionist. She became ill with Alzheimer's disease in her late 60s or early 70s, and she died 2 months after Jerry died in 2018. My parents were Jerry and Barbara Jo, and they had three biological children and they adopted one child. They had 16 grandchildren. There are 16 grandchildren and one great grandson. Only four of their grandchildren are still in elementary or high school. Several are in college and graduate school, and others are working. And another interesting fact is that my grandparents, when they left for India, were part of the Presbyterian Mission Board. After college, I had a very difficult time, went through a very difficult time spiritually, and I was looking for a church, and I lived in Philadelphia, and I ended up at a church where there was really wonderful Bible teaching, a wonderful loving fellowship, and I was finding it to be very healing, and only And it turned out that it was a Presbyterian church, a church that was part of the Presbyterian denomination. My brother, I then came with me to that church. I invited him, and he has now become a Presbyterian minister in New York. That's Dr. Starrett's grandson. My mother, Barbara Jo, and my husband and I, and my eldest daughter have all had opportunities to travel to India at various times. And each one of us has been to Highfield, and we are greatly encouraged to see that over many years and through the lives of many individuals, Jesus continues to make his glory known and extend his kingdom. UASI is a testimony to us to the powerful and steadfast love of Jesus, whereby he leads us and keeps us and unites us together. UASI is a foretaste of heaven, where we, a diverse people from every nation on earth, we'll be one family sharing in Christ's love forever. So thank you again for giving me this opportunity. And I'm looking forward to hearing more and learning more about Dr. Starrett.
Thank you so much, Jennifer, for sharing many details. Yeah, we are very much touched. And we are so grateful to the Starretts, and also to know that you are continuing that heritage, and may God continue to use you all for the extension of his kingdom. Yeah, thank you. God bless
you. Thank you. Thank you.
We have now an interview with Reverend Arthur Hope. Reverend Arthur Hope is another person who had close interactions with Dr. Starrett. So welcome, Arthur Annan. Thank you so much for joining. Please share with us some of your major memories about Dr. Skerritt and his impact in your life and in GSI. So please, over to you.
Yeah. I first met Dr. Skerritt in 1960. At that time, I was studying in Madurai for my second year in college, and I was sent for committee members' training camp. Dr. Skerritt met us at the bus stand in Kotagiri and took us straight to Highfield. I had no idea of Kotagiri, Ooty and all that, but he was so helpful and gave us the right place to stay and work. And he used to take the doctrine sessions, evening devotion sessions, Brother P.T. Chandrapilla. So Dr. Skerritt, every morning at 6 o'clock, will play his bugle. The whole Kotagiri town can hear nice songs. Early in the morning, 6 o'clock, he will play the bugle. And we also had to get up earlier than that, or at least by 6, we had to get up. And he was such a nice expert musician. We heard his song that he composed. Jesus commanded us something to do. Love one another as I have loved you. And he also used to, he and his wife, learn some new songs from US when they went on furlough. When they came back, they not only bought things for themselves, but bought some new songs for us, choruses and new songs. And in Kotagiri, we used to learn new songs. I was there not only in the student camp. Later, I was in one of the Bible study center. And we used to learn new songs brought to us by Dr. Skerritt and Mrs. Skerritt. And he was such a good Bible teacher. The doctrinal basis of UESI, which was very new to me. I was a new believer, just accepted Jesus as my savior in 1958. And this was just 2 years after. And the teachings received in Highfield put the right foundations for me. And he guided us along with the camp leader for going outings from Kotagiri to Ooty, to the botanical garden, and also to a place called Kodanad. Kodanad, from there you can see Karnataka side. Big dip will be there, and we can see across. So Kodanad visit, and Ooty visit, and a few other places also. He used to guide us, not only he, but also whoever was the camp leader. And Dr. Sterrett and Mrs. Sterrett had very good friends with a local bakery people, Royal Bakery. They were very committed and loyal to the Sterretts. When we went, the Royal Bakery people used to give one free evening tea with snacks and everything because of their loyalty to the Sterretts. I think Mrs. Sterrett must have taught them how to make cake and all. So they were so very helpful whenever we had our committee members training camp and other camps. So they taught us songs. They took us outside for outings and gave us very good lessons in how to study, how to interpret the Bible. I remember asking Dr. Sterrett some particular verse in a song. What does this mean? He smiled and looked at me and said, "Is this the only thing you don't understand?" There were many other things also in the same song, which I did not understand. But I asked him for one and he explained so nicely. So these are some of the good things. They made us welcome at Highfield. You know, first time 1960 when I went, and then afterwards as a study center student, the Sterretts always made us welcome, and we feel so happy to be there.
Thank you, Anand. Please tell us also how the Highfield property was gifted by them to the UESI.
Yes. See, they were living in Chennai. And the Kotagiri Medical Fellowship, there was a lady, an English lady. She wrote to Dr. Sterrett saying, "You are looking for a camp center, there is one coming for on sale. You come and see." So Dr. Sterrett and Mrs. Sterrett, they went to Kotagiri, saw that property, present Highfield. And the lady belonged to some tea company, and a single lady. She was very happy to give. It was almost sold to a local man. But the local man wanted to give half the amount first and half the amount after 6 months or something. And this lady was not for it. She wanted to sell the whole thing and go back to England. So when Dr. Sterrett went and said about our way of working, camp, conferences, and all that, she was very happy. And she gave the property for a very considerate rate also. So they bought it and they were using it. 10 months, 12 months, they will be using it. We will go there for 10 days, 14 days, and use it. Then he thought, this is not fair. He said, "You take over, you use it and maintain it." So around 49 or so, it was gifted to UESI. And after some time, not immediately, but after a few years, 1 or 2 years, they moved from the main bungalow to a small area, small portion, so that campers can have more time, more place. When I first went in 1960, about 20-25 people can stay. Now I understand more buildings have come up and nearly 100 people can stay now. But no, those days, 20-25, and Dr. Sterrett will be very happy to have only 25. 26 person coming, ayo, big problem. And the whole area we used to walk around and pray and for a real spiritual upbringing. It is a good place, and God has used it already. Yes, I remember your coming. You came to that elk field, elk spring. So, Dr. Sterrett, Professor Satkirti Rao, and Brother Satkirti, P.C. Varghese, and Brother Chandapilla, they were the main speakers for the camp, committee members training camp. So, God has used that place and is continuing to use that place, and we praise God.
Thank you so much, Anand, for giving so many details. Yeah, thank you so much. Praise God. May Lord continue to use you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Now we'll have by the media team PPT on high field, which will be followed by a recorded message by Sister Shelley Christopher. Yeah, so right now, first of all, we'll have a media PPT about the high field, about which Reverend Arthur Hope mentioned about it. And you can see the all the buildings and the latest situation there. Now, after that PPT, we'll have the recorded message by Sister Shelley Christopher on this terrace. Yeah, over to the media team. And you can see the all the buildings and the latest situation there. Now, after that PPT, we'll have the recorded message by Mr. Shelley Christopher on this terrace. Yeah, over to the media team. Thank you. Now we'll have the media playing the recorded message of Kelly Christopher. Now we'll have the media playing the recorded message.
It's indeed my joy and privilege to share the learnings and memories of Dr. Norton and Eloise Sterrett, who were certainly a loving and ideal Christian couple. A little about their profile. Dr. and Mrs. Sterrett were both from the USA. Eloise Sterrett was a classic beauty and a ballet dancer before her conversion.
Media playing the recorded message.
It's after that, she went to the Bible school, where she shared the learnings and memories of Dr. Sterrett's mother, Eloise Sterrett, who came to visit her son, loving and ideal and Christian couple,
to date her.
A little about their profile. Dr.
As an obedient son,
both from the USA,
he obeyed his mother
and asked Eloise for a date. And a ballet dancer.
As they went together for her conversion,
they decided to marry.
After that, she went to the Bible school,
where Dr. Sterrett never wanted to marry anyone of Dr. Sterrett's mother, Eloise Sterrett, who had come to visit her son, and Eloise and suggested,
but the difference could never be made out.
Dr. As an obedient son in Christ,
was he engraved in Eloise Sterrett's ring
and asked
was a classic
truly and totally
the ballet dancer
as they went together
for her conversion.
They decided
had two
to marry.
Children.
After that, she was a Bible
student.
I shared the
memory to marry anyone
of Dr. Sterrett's mother, Eloise Sterrett,
who was a young couple loving and
suggested
to help,
but the difference could never be made
out.
Dr.
As an obedient son in Christ,
the USA,
was
he engraved
in Mrs. Sterrett's
wedding ring
and asked
was a classic
truly
and totally
the ballet dancer
as they went together
for her.
Sorry, once again, I think we seem to have a serious bug. I think we'll skip the recorded message. I think whenever we have a recorded message, we seem to be having a problem. So we'll go ahead. The next interview will be with Professor Tally Hellinger, and Dr. Arjunan will be doing this interview. So over to Dr. Arjunan and Professor Tally Hellinger.
Uncle Tally Hellinger, good evening. We are very happy to have you here. And we are also honored. I have three questions to you. And the first question, Uncle, what are your impressions of Dr. Sterrett as you recall your first meeting with him in 1955 in a camp in Kolkata? Could you please?
Yeah, media team, can you check Professor Tally Hellinger got disconnected or not? Please, can you please check, please?
Yeah, can you ask him to switch on his video?
Yeah, Professor Hellinger, can you please switch on your video?
I think he's out.
He's out.
Yeah, he's here. Eunice Hellinger.
Yeah, good. So you could please put them on the spot.
Yeah. Charles, you can unmute him. Charles, unmute him, please.
All right. I'm grateful to you for giving me this opportunity. Okay.
Yes, Uncle. Uncle.
Yeah.
Could you please share your first impressions on meeting Dr. Sterrett way back in 1955 in a camp in Kolkata? Your first impressions of Dr. Sterrett.
When I met Dr. Sterrett first in an EU camp in October 1985, I was at once much impressed by his varied traits of life and personality. He was down to earth, humble. His attitude and approach towards me and all of us, very kind-hearted and compassionate, and interested deeply in me, in all of us. That is why during the camp period, I wanted to be always near him.
Mm.
He was radiant in his face, and occasionally he displayed wonderful and beautiful and very decent humor. I was enthralled by his beautiful expository teachings and preaching of the scriptures. To me, he was a Christ-like person to be ever admired and emulated in my life. Never had I imagined in my earlier days that I would be meeting such a person in my life. He was truly a person of aroma of Christ to me. I am eternally grateful to God for having enabled me to meet Dr. Dean Sterrett in life way back in October 1955.
Oh, thank you, Uncle. We understand that you made your commitment to the Lord Jesus in that particular camp. Now, could you please tell us what significant impact that your commitment has made in your personal life, family, and career?
Our God used this EU camp to bring complete transformation of life. The words of God in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, was truly fulfilled in my life by God's grace. I decided to live from then on according to the teachings of the Bible in all areas of my life. As per the mission and vision of the USI, I decided to live till the end of my life on earth, striving to be always evangelical. Living in a world full of darkness and evil, and having sinful nature in me, instead of my very sincere striving to live an ideal Christian life, I do admit I do fail sometimes in my spiritual life journey, yet open my genuine confession of my sins and being forgiven, I am able to keep going on, pressing on towards the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. I decided to be with students of colleges and universities in order to lead them to know Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. As such, I decided As such, I joined a government college in Nagaland, and I spent 10 years teaching history and also having very happy times with students through EU programs. Thereafter, I spent another 20 years in Kohima, capital city of Nagaland, serving in the Department of Education, enabling me by God's grace to reach the position of Director of Education. I spent very meaningful and fruitful times of service among our people till my retirement in the month of April 1994. But still, by God's grace, I am always with graduates and EUs and staff members of USA Nagaland. And I feel very privileged to be in this marvelous position of becoming more mature by the grace of God, the things of the Lord Jesus. My wife and I have been given a very happy Christian home. All our five children with their spouses are born again, and they are witnessing Christians. Some of them are even working as senior advisors among graduates and EUs. And all of them are today serving in various professional services.
Thank you. Thank you, Angel. We're really excited about the transformation that the camp has made on your life and the personal interaction with Dr. Sterrett. My last question to you, you are 89 years old, one of the senior most graduates in USA constituency. Now, what is your message to USA constituency, the students, graduates, and staff as a senior most graduate, Professor Talia Linger?
Yeah, thank you very much. By the grace of God, even now, God is graciously giving me good health. I don't have any physical ailment whatsoever by the grace of God. My faculties, hearing, eyesight, all those things are kept by the grace of God almost in normal condition. Therefore, my life belongs to God and praise for His glory alone.
Praise God. What is your message?
I want to answer, brother.
Yes.
Christ, being the hope of glory and panacea to all human miseries, I humbly and earnestly urge all members of USA constituency to ever strive with the help of the Holy Spirit to be conformed more and more to the image of Jesus Christ by walking in Him daily, rooted and built up in Him, deeply established in faith with thanksgiving. Let us all strive as members of USA family to be blameless, harmless, children of God without rebuke in the midst of a crooked and perverse world, among whom to shine as lights in the world, holding forth the word of life.
Praise God.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Uncle.
Thank
it's you. A wonderful, sound piece of advice. The USA is right now, constituency is right now listening. Only the friends from abroad also listening. Thank you for being with us. May the Lord help you to hit century in your life. Thank you so much. Over to Joseph John.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Uncle. Talia Linger Angel, and thank you, Dr. Arjunan. Yep, we are so encouraged and also challenged, you know, at the age of 89, you know, you are still strong in the Lord, and we praise God for you, especially starting the ministry. Northeast India ministry was pioneered by you. Praise all, praise be to God. So now we'll have an interview with Brother Cyril Kundar. Yeah, so media team, please put on spot both Cyril Kundar and me, please. Yeah, good. Yeah. Brother Cyril, thank you for joining us. Can you unmute? Can you unmute yourself, please? Can you first unmute?
Is it okay now?
Yes, it's okay. Yeah. So thank you so much, brother, because you were one of the persons who had very close interaction with Dr. Starrett. So please give your first-hand experience with Dr. Starrett in the Asian Bible Studies Center in Haiti.
Before my experience, I want to tell how I came there. As a high school teacher in the coastal town of Karnataka, I was happy with my students. But somehow inside me, I felt that God is going to call me for full-time ministry. I was not fully prepared. I didn't study in any seminary. I had a great fear of seminaries, the theologians, and the doctors of theology, and somehow I didn't like 4 years of studies in my intellect and exam oriented. My concept was to study to and get prepared under a man of God, devoted to Christ, study the word of God, and I had such desire in me. In a wonderful way, I don't have time now, I was led to Asian Bible Study Center. I got the application, filled in, and at the bottom, there was the director, Dr. T.N. Starrett. Oh, these doctors again, theologian, I was somewhat disappointed. Then I ran to one of my Christian friends, a servant of God, and asked him, by any chance, do you know this man, Dr. T.N. Starrett? Is he a high theologian or modern theologian or anything? His reply was something like this: Cyril, to be with him is like being in heaven. So on that, I applied and I was accepted. My first experiences, I cannot tell any, but just few I'll be presenting before you. Number one, Dr. Starrett's understanding of others' feelings. I came from a somewhat rural town where we don't hear much of English being spoken. So I had a picture of my own poor English with all the bad intonations and phonetics. Often my grammar was also wrong. So I was overconscious of it. So when I came to Kotagiri, I somehow had a time with Dr. Starrett and said all these things. My English is poor. My grammar is very bad. My phonetics is something very funny and all those things. He stopped me. He's curtly looked at my face and said, Cyril, if your English is poor, speak English, poor English. If your grammar is bad, you speak bad grammar. Your phonetics is wrong, but use the wrong phonetics. Don't you try to be someone else. Be Cyril only. And that made a great impact upon my life and gave me encouragement and boldness to go to any place just as I am, not trying to be someone else. Secondly, Dr. Starrett's disciplined life. He had a motto before him at the desk that read, do it now. Once I had a confusion about child baptism and immersion baptism. So I thought, now I'm in this Bible study time. this is the time for me to know very clearly and to stand firm. So I asked for an appointment. Confusion. I want to solve it once for all. Now I'll go to Dr. Starrett and share with him. And you speak, you teach me through him. Whatever he says, I'll accept. So with that prayer, I went and asked for an appointment. Do it now. His revolving chair turned swift, swung like, yes, Cyril, what is, immediately asked. And I shared very much about my doubt. And I asked him to guide me very clearly. He didn't answer anything. He just pulled out some of the books and booklets from his shelf and gave it to me and said, Cyril, take this. Go to your room, lock your door, and first empty your heart of all sorts of bias for or against or anything. With an open heart, you go through these books. Then you kneel down. You have a personal savior. And he will teach you, and just do that. I did that, and it was a great help for me. Even after in my life, when I had confusions over like doctrine of Holy Spirit, same method I used, and always God, my personal savior, guided me very clearly. I could stand on firm doctrine. Thirdly, Dr. Starrett's sense of humor. He was not a doctor or a director of that institute. We shared the same dining table, and he used to be full of fun, even Mrs. Starrett also. Once, for example, one of our teachers was leaving India back to New Zealand or Australia, I forgot. And we were all there as volunteers to help him. A van came, and he had brought all his luggage out, so much of it, all the baggages. So I thought this van will not hold it, we have to go get another one also. When we went to help him, he said, no, leave me alone. Then he started packing it inside the small van. Ultimately, all the luggage went in. So I was amazed, and I was sharing with my friend. I wonder how he did it. Dr. Starrett overheard it. Come on, tell me how he did it. We said, it's proper planning. No. It may be one man handling. No. Whatever we used our brains and tech, he said, no, very seriously. So we are feeling as if we failed in an exam. Then he looked at us with a smile. He put his index finger to his head and said, kidney. And we laughed at it. He was joking, not the brain. He was telling like that. So full of fun. Fourthly, Dr. Sarah's transparency. I appreciated very much over this. One day we were playing volleyball. You know that small court we had. Only two players can play on either side. So I had an Australian with me, very tall, and he was very good at that. Opposite was Dr. Starrett and his companion. I didn't know the rules or anything, but I was so excited. So all I wanted to do is to send the ball out on the other side. So it was a ding-dong battle, and we fought almost one again, went down like that. Ultimately, we lost. Then we came for the evening devotion in Highfield building. Dr. Starrett was to lead that Bible study. He said, before I begin, I want to share something. After our game, I washed and I was praying. And God convicted me. While we were playing, the rule says, our rule is, the one who serves the service, he should not step in before it passes over the net, which I didn't know. I used to be excited and send it and jump in. He said it was foul. He said, several times I pulled out Cyril and said it is foul. But once I saw my own teammate doing that, and I kept quiet. Cyril, please forgive me. I almost wept. And that was a great lesson to be transparent before people. Fifthly, his teaching. We have heard about his teaching already. For me, it was all well-balanced and Bible-based and very definite about doctrines. So that helped me. That's why I was longing for that. So it paid the foundation for my future Christian life. There was no emotion, high emotions, hi-fi, always emphasized on moderation. And he will insist, he will never insist his opinion on others, but keep it open. It was all Bible-based. I remember I was talking to one of my classmates about Psalm 46:10. Be still and know that I am God. So I was telling him, see, in English is so beautiful. Be still, wait upon, and he'll in a different world and you'll know Lord. But in my vernacular, Kannada, it is not like that. It is as if he's saying, leave me alone. I am God. What a difference is there, I said. Then Dr. Starrett overheard, called me. Cyril, never interpret things like that without you, without knowing the original. Do it now. He opened his books. I don't know whether it's Hebrew or Greek. He studied that and said, Kannada translation is closer to the originals than in English. He is sovereign. You leave it. I'll do it. I am God. That's the thought there, he said. Likewise, we had so many things we learned through him. Sixthly, his humility. Whatsoever you do, do it as unto the Lord. It would be seen in him. And Mrs. Starrett also, we have heard about that already. One day I had to get my book from my Shamrock room, so I ran down from the classroom. I heard someone was there whistling. And who was it? Mrs. Starrett teaching, cleaning all our toilets. With my own eyes, I have seen Dr. Starrett with a long, thick wire pulling out in and out from the lavatory with a bunch of a pack of waste in his hand, but still cleaning it and again inserting and taking. What a man he was. He was willing to do any menial work as unto the Lord. When he is in ministry, we all should be willing to do any job, menial, not to sit in a high place like that. Fifthly, his foresight. I remember Brother Chandrapilla's obituary article in USI magazine when Dr. Starrett was called home. There he said, Dr. Starrett as a pioneer labored very much with all the ups and downs and problems in the early years. And later on, when it...
Brother Cyril, you got... please unmute. You got muted. You got muted. Yeah, again got muted. Yeah, again got muted. Yeah. So, Brother Cyril, you got again muted. Can you unmute? Can you unmute again?
Is it okay now?
Yes.
So, when the work somewhat got established and stabilized, Chandrapilla wrote, he found me down below and he pulled me out of that place and put me on top and he worked under me. Anyone will put up on someone else as a successor and go away, but he worked under him, guiding me, advising me, supporting me. This is the servant leadership. I greatly appreciate that.
So thank you so much, Brother Cyril. Thank you so much for sharing all the details of Dr. Starrett's life. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
The high field dining hall, the students are assembled there. So if brothers in high field could just show students, Brother Frankie or anyone in the dining hall, but all the CMBC students are present there, he could show us. You could see students sitting in the meeting hall. Praise God for all of them. Wonderful. They are listening to this. So you can see Highfield students sitting there and listening to the talk. Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you. Yeah. So we are slightly running late before we kind of wind up. We also want to have, right now we have with us Brother John Martin and also Sister Jane. So I request the media team to please put them on spot.
Can this John... on the video?
Yeah, please, yeah. John Martin and Jane Martin.
Just can you ask them to switch on the video, please?
Yeah. So request Brother John Martin to switch on your video, please. So John Martin, please switch on your video so that the media team could put you on spot. Brother John Martin.
Just, I think they're not
fine. Yeah. So, shall we, Jacob, can you, so what we want to try once again, we had problems playing the recorded message of Sister Shelly Christopher. So, I request Jacob, we'll try one last time. Jacob, please, can you play at your end, please? Only thing, when you share the video, please also share the audio also, please. Yeah.
It's indeed my joy and privilege to share the learnings and memories of Dr. Norton and Eloy Sterrett, who are certainly a loving and ideal Christian couple. A little about their profile. Dr. and Mrs. Sterrett were both from the USA. Eloy Sterrett was a classic beauty and a ballet dancer before her conversion. After that, she went to the Bible school where Dr. Sterrett was studying. Dr. Sterrett's mother, who came to visit her son, saw Eloy's and suggested to date her. As an obedient son, he obeyed his mother and asked Eloy's for a date. As they went together, they decided to marry. But the irony was, Mrs. Sterrett never wanted to marry anyone who was younger or shorter than her. And Dr. Sterrett was both shorter and younger. But the difference could never be made out. One in Christ was engraved in Mrs. Sterrett's wedding ring. They were truly and totally one in Christ. They had two children, Jerry and Anne. I cherish the memories spent with Terrence, especially with Mrs. Terrett. As a young couple, they came to India to help in the church ministry in Jhansi. Dr. Terrett had learned Urdu well. Later, he became the first staff worker of the USI. As a couple, they have greatly contributed in the lives of our former staff workers, P.T. Chandapilla, P. Satyajit Rao, and P.C. Verghese. They built them up individually, personally, and in the ministry. Dr. Sterrett bought Highfield with the gift that he received from his father after the father retired. Later, Highfield became the conference center of the USI. God gave the Suresh a promise. In this place, I give peace. God, in his faithfulness, has been fulfilling this promise in the lives of all those who have been attending different programs at different times in Highfield over the years. In fact, it was here at Highfield that the Lord dealt with me personally for a total surrender and called me for the ministry. Dr. Starek was a man of intellect, a scholar, a musician, and a good teacher. Yet he was very simple and approachable. You could ask him any question, and most of the time, he made you answer your own questions. His book, How to Study the Bible, was first of its kind, was an IVP publication. Mrs. Starek was very motherly, caring, with a very good aesthetic sense. In the main building of Highfield, where the meeting room, dining room, and kitchen. There were two bedrooms on either side. The meeting hall had only small benches to sit and one or two chairs for the speakers and a piano. The staff and students would volunteer to help Mrs. Starek in cleaning and washing dishes, etc. In the process, they chipped off her beautiful crockery, broke, and walked with dirty feet on the carpets and spilled water on the floor, which bothered Mrs. Terrell greatly to begin with. However, as time went by, the Lord taught her a beautiful lesson. Things are to be used and people are to be loved, which became a reality to her. Dr. Said used to come early to the classroom and make sure that everybody had a place to sit. He would come with long sheets of fresh preparation for each class. He was always the first to come and last to leave. During the class, when he asked questions, we were expected to raise our hands. Only when he asked, we had to answer so that all could be heard. Dr. Stead was a very practical person. He used to trim the hedges and repair broken furniture during his free time. It was a common sight to see Dr. Stead going around Highfield with hammer in his hand to
Jacob, please unmute. Jacob, can you unmute, please? Yeah, Jacob, you have to unmute yourself. Yeah.
Just use for all purposes. And the rainwater was collected carefully in drums and tanks and used for all purposes. Cooking, drinking, of course, boiled, and cleaning and bathing, etc. Bath was with half zinc can of water and just twice a week. But I never had heard anyone grumble complain or pass a negative comment on these limitations. Everyone seemed to enjoy the stay at Highfield. Once I asked Mrs. Tarrant, "You look so beautiful even in your old age. I wonder how you looked when you were young. I would like to see your younger days photos." She laughed and said, "I never ever dreamt that anybody would ask for my photos." They had gradually shifted their things to their homeland. However, one morning she called me and showed me a photo in black and white which she found in Dr. Sarah's wallet. She looked so beautiful with her thick plaits around her head. I asked Mrs. Tarrant, "Why not others also see this beautiful photo?" She agreed. It was so fragile that I had to hold it in my hand and show it to the whole group. Dr. Sarrant was so shocked and said aloud, "Shirley, how did you ever get it?" I smiled and said, "From the right source and the right means." Why am I saying all this? Just to show how Study Center had a friendly family atmosphere with such freedom. It was truly a home away from home, where there was learning in depth from the Lord and His Word and from one another, which made tremendous impact on our life. I had the privilege of attending Study Center twice, once for 3 months and second time for 6 weeks. Later, Mr. and Mrs. John Martin took up the responsibility of directing the Study Center courses. Dr. and Mrs. Tarrant volunteered to leave their room in Highfield for their successors and moved to a small room in the outhouse of Shamrock. In this small room, Dr. Sarrant had kept his accordion, bugle, trumpet, typewriter, etc. Hence, this room was called Gadget Room. They used a small Indian toilet. So graciously and lovingly, they demonstrated servant leadership and also developed second line of leaders. One of the songs Dr. Sarrant had composed and set music, "Love One Another," is still so meaningful and quite popular and sung by one and all. The present dining hall and meeting room was not existing during Sarrant's time. Just before they returned to their home country, the U.S. executive asked the Sarrants to break the ground for the construction of the new kitchen and dining hall. Dr. Sarrant declined. They didn't want their name to be seen anywhere. But you'll see the name Sarrant in the pages of many, many hundreds of books that Dr. Sarrant had donated to the USI library. Though their names are not written anywhere in Highfield, their names are engraved in the hearts and lives of many, many people, which will go for generations. Much later, as new buildings came up, one block was called as Sarrant Block. The last I saw Mrs. Sarrant was in 1988 in Philadelphia, where she was staying with her daughter Anne. Mrs. Sarrant was very free and her memory was fading. She kept smiling and said, "Let's go to India, Highfield." And she remembered the name of Satkirti. The Sarrants never saw running water or the present facilities of Highfield, but they have left a rich legacy of simplicity, sincerity, sacrifice, and servant leadership for generations to come. Amen.
Praise God. We are so grateful to the Sterets, and we especially thank Shalyaka for giving this detailed recording. We have come almost to the end of the program. I'll just share the takeaways, the major takeaways, just share. Yeah. So we have been listening to many of the all the resource persons and the various things they shared. And I just put here a few takeaways. One of the things I've been very much impressed reading, going through their through their biography, was they were all things to all men, loving people, giving themselves fully to them. And also we heard from other resource persons about their life of integrity, you know, to be transparent, and also servant leadership, you know, the humility, the way how they served and to all students and graduates, and the way in Highfield how they were instrumental in ministering to many. The other thing, major takeaway we have seen, is their commitment to teaching Bible accurately. And finally, the music ministry. We just now heard about the song which has commanded us, something to do, which was composed by Professor Dr. Sterett. But also, they had a music ministry, and we heard that from Mrs. Jennifer Ball also. So we praise God for their lives, and I hand it over to Brother Frankie Fernandez for vote of thanks. Stop sharing. So Brother Frankie. You are muted.
Charles.
Thank you. Thank you, Brother Joseph John, for this lovely program. And I have just two words as I was thinking about this whole program, is towards hashtag inspired and hashtag moved. Amazing. This whole journey of the Sterets, and what better place to watch this lovely place, Highfield. I don't know, I'm shivering with cold, but then cold temperature, but I am so pleased and I enjoyed every bit of the program. You know, I had so many, and I just one or two to recollect. As Jennifer said, they loved most the people. They loved most the people, despite, you know, coming from the US and then staying here. And when they went back, they remembered the people, and then repeatedly the servant leadership, cleaning and toilets, and you know, this theme was often repeated. And finally, Auntie Shirley said, simplicity, legacy of simplicity, sacrifice, and servant leadership. Amazing. Thank you all for your inspiring anecdotes that you've shared. Thanks, Jennifer, from United States, staying back in the program. I don't, probably you're still there in the program, I can't see, but thank you for joining and sharing such wonderful things. And thank you, Reverend Arthur Hope, all the religious Hellinger, amazing testimony and all that you shared. Just remembered is the kidney humor. There are many things, of course, which you shared. Then also, I want to thank the two people who worked very hard to coordinate this program. Brother Joseph John himself, who was anchoring, and Brother Arjunan, who was actually instrumental for this tale of the legend that you see behind me, the biography of Dr. T. N. Starrett. Thank you so much for your contribution, and thank you, CND team. I know there were a lot of challenges, but I'm sure you worked hard. You have done your best. The lovely presentation, the music, and it was lovely. Thank you so much for coordinating the audio, video, the media. Thank you, student leaders who joined, and also all the students who sang from CMDC right here, who entertained us with the song. Thank you so much. And last but not least, the FAD team for organizing this entire program. And thank you for all of you for joining this program. I know it is not the best of time on a Saturday evening to join this program, but you've joined and been a part of this lovely evening. Thank you so much. I had the pleasure of hearing and also thanking you all. And so now we close this program with a word of prayer, and I would request our student leader to and to pray and
Uncle Joseph, am I audible?
Yes, you're audible. Yeah,
please. Yes, thank you so much, sir. Shall we all look to God and pray and close the meeting? Let's look to God and pray. Gracious Lord, Heavenly Father, King of all the kings, the master planner, the creator, the source of all loves, thank you, Lord Jesus. We worship you and we acknowledge your presence. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, for bringing each and every one of us across the country and across the globe to come together in this platform to remember and celebrate the impactful life of Dr. T.N. Starrett and his wife. We thank you, Lord, that you have given us the opportunity to learn through his life, and that you have spoken to us as we recollect the memories and all the events and the ministry that you have started through Dr. T.N. Starrett. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that you have touched many lives through his ministry. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the desire that you have put into the hearts of Dr. Starrett's, and that, Lord Jesus, you have brought them to India to bring the good news to India. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the principle that you have spoken to us. That, and you have encouraged us and you reminded us to love our neighbor, love one another. And that, Lord Jesus, to serve you with your mighty strength according to your perfect plan. That boundaries and geographies will not scare us, but Lord Jesus, you have wonderfully sustained the ministry, which started as a seed in the hearts of one couple and have grown into such a ministry, your ministry that is UESI ministry. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the gift that you have given to UESI through Dr. Starrett, Starrett's family. And we thank you, Lord, for multiplying this wonderful gift that you have given to us, the conference center that you have given to us through Dr. T.N. Starrett. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And we come together to before your throne of grace, Lord Jesus, that for all people who are gathered here today, Lord Jesus, may you enable us to get rooted in your love, strive to grow in your likeness, and continue to witness wherever we are, just as Dr. Tian's Spirit have done. Lord Jesus, just as you have mightily used Dr. Tian's life for your glory, may you continue to work in all of our lives. Help us, Lord Jesus, in all the struggles that each of us face in our walk with you, that we will not give up, but Lord Jesus, commit ourselves to you. Just as he said to do it now, we invite your Holy Spirit into each of our life to revive us, to transform us, and that we will take up the urgency wherever we are, as students, as graduates, as staff, to stand up and walk for your glory. Even at this point of time, we pray for the CMTC delegates, the friends who are attending the camp now at this moment. We pray that, Lord Jesus, you will continue to speak to them. We pray for all the resource persons who are guiding them and mentoring them through all the sessions and doctrines and devotions. We also pray for the family, the grandchildren, and the great-grandchildren of Dr. Tian Sterrett, Lord Jesus, that you will continue to be with them, and that you will continue to sustain the ministry, bless each and every one of them in the days to come. All these things I ask and pray in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you. So the program is formally closed. Yeah, but you're welcome to stay on and greet one another. Thank you for joining. Yeah, special greetings to all the CMTC students. It was so nice that you're all there. Praise God. Yeah. I'll request the media team to put them on spot. Yeah. Thank you so much. It was so nice to see you all in Kotagiri.
Hello. Saji and company.
So nice.
Saji, sir.
Come here. Saji, it is so nice to see you, Saji.
Yes.
So nice to see you and the CTMTC group. We are happy.
I like them.
Take a bag, can you play the song, please?
Jacob, can you play that Jesus commanded us something?
Yeah, 1 minute. Give
me a second. Maybe let me mute everybody and then do it.
I want to go. One button.
The Kotagiri Center students.
Yeah, we are trying to play that songs.
Thank you, Brother Joseph John.
Yeah. So Jacob is trying to play that song.
Sorry,
commanded us something to do.
You want to sing otherwise?
Yeah. Maybe the MDC students can sing live. Why don't they sing live?
Right?
Yes. And I think
So Jacob, maybe the best thing, maybe the same thing is for us to play it live. They can directly play if they are ready.
Okay.
Jacob, you have to share the audio also. Share the audio also. Jacob, can you stop again and share, but share also the audio. Share also the audio. Then only you come. Yeah, otherwise we can request the students right now in CMPC category to sing live. So Jacob will request the CMPC students to play, sing it live, please. Yeah, Saji, if you could unmute and ask the students to sing live.
So thank you, Joseph Renan. At last, we have successfully navigated the program.
Praise be to God.
It's quite common in such program.
Online program. Thank you so much.
Otherwise, it went on well, and it gave me a chance to go through the book once again. I read the whole thing.
So we look forward to the third edition of the book by next year.
So we'll discuss with the publication department, Jacob. Jacob is here.
Jacob is there. So Jacob will be only very happy if you have the third edition.
I'm here.
Jacob.
I'm here, Anand.
I'll be busy till December. So we'll take it up.
Can you hear me? I'm here.
Yeah?
I'm listening.